All right. Well, good evening and welcome to this edition of History and Highballs as part of the North Carolina Museum of History's History at Home initiative. We're so glad that you're joining us for this evening's program, History and Highballs, the Halifax Resolves. My name is Stacey and I handle adult education over at the museum. So whenever you join us for one of these History and Highballs programs, you and I get to virtually spend the evening together listening to some incredible stories about North Carolina places and people and what makes our state so special. Tonight's program is just one of many exciting virtual offerings available through MOH. So if you'd like to learn more about our History at Home initiative, we invite you to head over to the museum's website at www.ncmuseumofhistory.org. This is also where you can find information about shopping at the museum shop, whether in person or online, and joining our North Carolina Museum of History Associates. Our associates and foundation provide crucial funding and support to the museum, which, in addition to many other things, helps make programming like this evening's program happen. We would like to thank all of those of you who graciously donated funds towards this evening's program. We do our best to keep our programs free to attend, but there are costs associated with keeping our series going, and we just continue to be so appreciative of your generous support of the museum. A few quick housekeeping items for this evening. We ask that you please keep your mics muted throughout the entirety of the program. And to please type any questions you have for our guest speakers into the chat function located at the bottom center of your screen. At the end of the program, I will ask our speakers as many of your questions as time allows. Okay, so it's my honor to introduce this evening's speakers, Larry Armstrong, Chair of Historic Halifax Restoration Association. The Historic Halifax Restoration Association, also known as HHRA, was organized in June of 1954 as a nonprofit when 150 people decided to save, restore, and preserve historic sites in Halifax. In addition to currently serving as chair of the board of directors for HHRA, Larry is a resident of Enfield, North Carolina, and an attorney with a lifelong interest in history. He also participated in the outdoor production of First for Freedom in the 1970s. Our second speaker this evening is Vann Evans, who is the audiovisual materials archivist and guru for the State Archives of North Carolina. And tonight's program would not have been possible without the foresight and leadership of Karen Vaughn, who currently serves as vice chair of the board of directors for the Museum of History in Raleigh, as well as chair of board of directors for the Friends of Historic Halifax. The Friends of Historic Halifax, or FOHH, is a state-associated nonprofit organization that was initiated in 2017 as a support group for the Historic Halifax site. Karen is a resident in an 1855 Halifax County plantation that was owned by her husband's great-great-grandfather, Reverend John Wellesley Heppenstall. We'll be sharing the websites for these organizations in the chat if you'd like to learn more about them. Okay, so Larry, I believe you're gonna lead us off. I'm gonna turn it over to you. Welcome, thanks for being with us this evening.
Well, I'm excited about there are people that are interested in hearing the story of Halifax. And I'm glad to share with you that story tonight. A couple of disclaimers first. I have no idea why they call this program History and Highballs. I know what I'm normally doing this time of day and I have my suspicions, but I don't know. So you'll have to ask someone else that question if that's a question you have. Second of all, I do not claim to be a professional historian. I'm just a small town lawyer who's interested in history. I told one of my colleagues one time, the only claim I have to be an historian is the fact that I took courses under Hugh Leffler at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill back in the 70s when Roy Williams and I were undergraduates. Those of you that are older will remember that Dr. Leffler wrote the textbook, or at least was one of the writers of the textbook that was used in North Carolina history in the public schools for many years. But I'm not a professional historian. I will be happy to answer any questions that you ask if I know the answers. If I don't, I will tell you that I do not. When George Washington visited the small town of Halifax in April of 1791, as a part of his Southern tour, he wrote in his journal, "The town seems to be in decline, and it is said contains about 1,000 souls." As usual, President Washington was very perceptive. The town of Halifax is still a small town. It's on the south bank of the Roanoke River, about 5 miles east of I-95 and about 15 miles south of the Virginia border. It's still the county seat where the courthouse is and most of the county offices are. But when the courthouse closes and all the county employees go home, the population of Halifax now is less than 300. But America's small towns have great stories to tell. And tonight, I want to share with you part of the Halifax story. On April the 4th, 1776, when the 4th Provincial Congress convened at Halifax, Halifax was a small town then, but it was one of the more important communities in North Carolina. Its docks on the south bank of the Roanoke River were busy with riverboats and sloops coming and going, delivering agricultural products to the towns of Edenton and further down the coast and out into the ocean. The houses, mostly of whiteboard, were clustered around a courthouse green. Many of the delegates to the Provincial Congress were staying at the Eagle Tavern, which still exists in the town of Halifax, or were the guests of the Widow Eelbeck, who you may hear more about tonight. The Masonic Lodge in town claimed to have the only Grand Master of North America, the only one that ever was, in the person of Joseph Montfort, who was the clerk of court. On the outskirts of town, along Quonky Creek, there were stately plantation homes, including the Grove, the home of Whig leader Wiley Jones, who owned some of the best racehorses in the colonies, ridden by Austin Curtis, the Michael Jordan of his era, who was a skilled jockey to the extent that the North Carolina legislature acted to free him from slavery because of his skills. Across Quonky Creek, Colonel Nicholas Long had built workshops to produce uniforms and other military supplies for what seemed to be the coming war with Britain. When the moderator, Samuel Johnson, called the Congress to order on that April day, 245 years ago, there were 83 delegates present. Those delegates were about to embark on a journey unique in the history of the world, and which would forever and profoundly change their world in ways at that point they could not yet conceive. Let's set the stage for this Congress. The Boston Massacre, the Boston Tea Party were history at this point. In August 1774, when the Royal Governor Martin refused to call the Colonial Assembly of North Carolina into session, they called themselves into session. Same delegates that would have been in the Colonial Assembly were in the first Provincial Congress. In that first Provincial Congress and the second and third succeeding meetings of Congress, they organized committees of safety to perform the functions of local government in the absence of British government. They created for themselves a 13-member provisional council with executive powers to govern the colony when the Congress was not in session. President of that 13-member council was a distiller and merchant from the Wilmington area named Cornelius Harnett. For all practical purposes, Harnett was the chief executive in North Carolina in the absence of a royal governor, no governor having yet been elected because there was no structure in place in North Carolina to elect a governor. The Provisional Congress has selected delegates to meet with other delegates from other states in the Continental Congress in Philadelphia. They also divided the colony into six military districts and provided for the organization and equipping of militia from each of those districts. Now, what was going on elsewhere? April 19th, 1775, skirmishes were fought with British troops on the Green in Lexington, Massachusetts, and at the bridge in Concord, Massachusetts. That summer in 1775, the Royal Governor of North Carolina, Martin, fled from Tryon Palace for a British warship in the Cape Fear River. On June 17th, 1775, New England troops fought in a pitched battle with British troops on Breed's Hill in Boston, which later became mistakenly known as the Battle of Bunker Hill. On December 9th, 1775, Halifax militia from Halifax, North Carolina, under Colonel Nicholas Long, were engaged in the Battle of Great Bridge in the colony of Virginia at a bridge just south of Norfolk, Virginia. And then on February 27th, 1776, on a bridge over Moore's Creek in southeastern North Carolina. North Carolina militia, under the command of Richard Caswell, intercepted and defeated 1,500 Highlander loyalists on their way to Brunswick to join with other British troops in an effort to control the Cape Fear region of North Carolina. Blood had now been shed on North Carolina soil at the Battle of Morse Creek Bridge. In the aftermath of Morse Creek, when the Congress convened a couple of months later on April 4th in Halifax, they had before them the usual concerns of governing the province and the military preparations that obviously were going to have to be made. But there was more. In the words of Samuel Johnston of Edenton, who was elected president of the Provincial Congress, all of our people here are up for independence. It seems that though all of these skirmishes and battles that had been going on throughout the colonies were taking place, the elected officials who were now seeking to govern the colonies had not kept up with what was going on in the field. And politically, nothing had happened and no one had made a decision about how the colonies were going to be governed from this place forward, from this point forward. In recognition of the feelings in North Carolina concerning independence, and understand these delegates were from all over North Carolina, not just the eastern part, all over North Carolina, Salisbury, Hillsborough, Cross Creek, everywhere that had an organized local council of safety had delegates in Halifax for this meeting. In recognition of this movement for independence in North Carolina on Monday, April the 8th, exactly 245 years ago today, the Provincial Congress meeting in Halifax adopted a resolution appointing a committee. And this was the direction to that committee to take into consideration the usurpations and violences attempted and committed by the King and Parliament of Great Britain against America, and the further measures to be taken for frustrating the same, and for the further better defense of this province. There were seven members appointed to that committee. All of those members at the time were well known and highly regarded, but unfortunately, little known and mostly forgotten in our time. If I called out to you the names of Nash and Harnett and Burke and Person and Jones and ask you what those names meant to you, you would tell me why, of course, they're counties in North Carolina, and they are. But if you add to that list of names the name Kitchen, they're also the members of the committee that was appointed by the Provincial Congress. John Kitchen was a prominent Orange County lawyer and judge. Thomas Person, surveyor in Warren County, seized by trying for earlier for fighting for the regulators. There's a building on the UNC campus named for him. Abner Nash of New Bern became the second governor of North Carolina. His house was burned by the British during the war. Alan Jones, born and raised in Northampton County, educated at Eton in England, served in the Continental Congress, was a brigadier general during the Revolutionary War, father-in-law of William R. Davy, which is another Halifax story. Thomas Jones of Chowan County. Jones was a participant and delegate to all five of the provincial congresses. Thomas Burke, Orange County. Burke was born in Dublin, immigrated to the colonies, practiced law and medicine, was a writer and poet, and at one point became governor of North Carolina. Some historians credit him with the language of the 10th Amendment to the United States Constitution, which provides that powers not given to the federal government belong to the states. And then there was Cornelius Harnett of Brunswick and Wilmington. He had been called by some people in New England, Samuel Adams of North Carolina. He was the one in 1775 that was elected president of the Provisional Council. For all intents and purposes, at this point, he was the chief executive of North Carolina. In May of 1776, in a last-ditch effort to save North Carolina from the British, British General or Admiral Sir Henry Clinton offered a pardon to every citizen of North Carolina that would lay down their arms and declare their allegiance to Great Britain, except for two people. One of those people was Robert Hay, who commanded the North Carolina militia. The other person singled out for that special exception, Cornelius Harnett. Harnett later served in the Continental Congress for 3 years. He was actually captured by the British in 1781, but was in such poor health, they released him, and he died shortly thereafter. You'll recall that when the Declaration of Independence was signed, it says that the people signing mutually pledged their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor. That happened to some of these people that were on that committee. R.D.W. Connor, in 1909, Connor was a well-known North Carolina historian who became the head of National Archives in Washington, wrote an essay about revolutionary leaders in 1909. He says about this committee, to Cornelius Harnett fell the task of drafting the committee's report. And here's what Connor said about that report. With great self-control, in a report remarkable for its calm dignity and restraint, but alive with suppressed emotion, he drew an indictment against the British ministry not equaled by any similar document of the revolutionary period, except only the Great Declaration itself. So what was the content of that resolution? On April the 12th, 1776, Cornelius Harnett read the resolution of the committee and submitted that resolution to the Provincial Congress for their action. It was in the form of resolution that we would propose today. The first thing that was written in that resolution was a report of all of the reasons for the resolution, without going into great detail, but just to summarize what those reasons were. Harnett said in the resolve that the king and parliament have usurped the power and property of the people of this colony in an unlimited and uncontrolled way. Legislative acts of the British parliament have called war, famine, and calamity to this continent. The armies and fleets of Great Britain have been destroying the people and committing what Harnett called horrid devastations. The royal governors have promoted slave insurrection. The royal navy has seized shipping and cargoes from American ships. And in general, the people have been destroyed or reduced to what Harnett calls lamentable distress. The resolution continues. And whereas the moderation hereto manifested by the United Colonies and their sincere desire to be reconciled to the mother country on constitutional principles have procured no mitigation of the aforesaid wrongs and usurpations, and no hopes remain of obtaining redress by those means alone which have hitherto been tried, your committee are of the opinion that the House should enter into the following resolve: that the delegates of this colony in the Continental Congress be empowered to concur with the delegates of the other colonies in declaring independency and forming formal alliances, reserving to this colony the sole and exclusive right of forming a constitution and laws for this colony, and of appointing delegates from time to time under the direction of the general representation thereof to meet the delegates of the other colonies for such purposes as shall be hereinafter pointed out. This resolution, now called the Halifax Resolves, was unanimously adopted by the 83 delegates in attendance. The delegates to the Continental Congress at this time were William Hooper and John Penn and Joseph Hughes. Hooper and Penn were on their way to Halifax at the time the resolves were adopted and because they wanted to participate in the Provisional Congress. Joseph Hughes remained in Philadelphia. Immediately after the adoption of the resolution, the resolves, a copy was sent to the Continental Congress in Philadelphia. Hughes or Penn haven't arrived. The resolution was sent to Hughes in Philadelphia. Penn haven't arrived in Halifax. Immediately wrote a letter to John Adams in Philadelphia. And I want to share with you some of the comments in that letter from John Penn to John Adams in Philadelphia. Halifax, April 17th, 1776. After a tedious journey occasioned by bad roads and wet weather, I arrived here in good health. Lord Cornwallis with 7 regiments are expected to visit us every day. Clinton is now in the Cape Fear. All regard of fondness for the king or the nation of Britain is gone. A total separation is what they want. Independence is a word most used. They ask if it is possible that any colony after what has been passed can wish for reconciliation. The convention have tried to get the opinion of the people at large. I am told that in many counties there was not one dissenting voice. The people think they can do anything. They are determined to die hard. I never saw men appear to have more spirit and be more determined. Compliments to your brother delegates, also the gentlemen of Virginia. I had not time to write them. Colonel Lee, remember that name, and Mr. Wythe will not be displeased at the sight of this. Recall this was April the 12th, 1776. A month later, and if you go to Williamsburg and watch that old film they play with Jack Lord, you'll see a depiction of this. On May 15th, 1776, the Revolutionary Virginia Convention, then meeting in Williamsburg, passed a resolution instructing the Virginia delegates in the Continental Congress to propose to that respectable body to declare the United Colonies free and independent states, absolved from all allegiance to and dependence upon the crown of the Parliament of Great Britain. In accordance with those instructions, on June 7th in Philadelphia, Colonel Richard Henry Lee, proposed a resolution to Congress, and it was seconded by John Adams. The Continental Congress was still not ready. More than 3 weeks passed before 12 of the 13 colonies approved a resolution of independence on July 2nd, 1776. The final draft of the Declaration of Independence, of course, was written by Thomas Jefferson with the help of Benjamin Franklin and John Adams. Though more eloquent, the Declaration itself, in both substance and form, was remarkably similar to the Halifax Resolves. When you think of independence, the Declaration of Independence, the Revolutionary period, you think of John Adams and John Hancock, Sam Adams and Paul Revere. As a North Carolinian, we should be thinking of Harnett and Burke and Nash and Person and Jones. Again, from R.D.W. Connor. In concluding his discussion of the Halifax Resolves, Connor says this: comment is unnecessary. The actors, the place, the occasion, the time, the action itself tell their own story. Sadly to say, a century later, I fear that sentence is no longer true. Few people in North Carolina know why the date April 12, 1776 appears on the North Carolina state flag or on the Great Seal of North Carolina. In the cacophony in which we live of email and tweets and Facebook and instant messaging and alternate facts and true hyperbole and false equivalents and yes, even Zoom meetings, the story of Halifax and its resolves has been lost in the fog of history. The challenge for us today is not only to keep the story of Halifax and its resolves alive, but to ensure that every citizen of North Carolina and beyond understands why the day should be remembered. The Declaration of Independence was an explosion that rocked the world and changed the course of history. But it was the 4th Provincial Congress in Halifax, North Carolina on April 12th, 1776, that lit the fuse. The resolves are just one of the stories, a part of the history of Halifax. The first constitution for the state of North Carolina was drafted later that year in Halifax. Cornwallis and his army occupied Halifax in 1791. William R. Davy, who became one of the founding fathers of the United States of America, was living in Halifax at the time he served in the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia. William R. Davy was also the founder of the University of North Carolina, was living in Halifax when that occurred. Davy and his father-in-law, Wally Jones, were on opposite sides of the debate about the United States, whether to adopt the United States Constitution. Davy being the Federalist aligned with Alexander Hamilton, and Wally Jones on the opposite side. This debate was taking place in Halifax at the same time those two men were responsible for primarily for founding the University of North Carolina. So there are other stories to tell in Halifax. I'm sure you're probably aware that there is an historic site in Halifax. We would urge you to visit that site to learn more about the Halifax Resolves, the history of Halifax, that small town on the south side of the Roanoke River in northeastern North Carolina, where history was made on April the 12th, 1776.
Thank you so much, Larry. Vann, I believe you're up.
Thank you so much for that wonderful presentation, Larry, and to the museum staff and for Stacy for putting this event on. I'm the audiovisual archivist at the State Archives, so I work with a lot of 20th century or 21st century materials. But I have a longstanding interest in the colonial and revolutionary period and have been fortunate to be able to work with a lot of these documents to provide access to them in the state archives. And I want to share with you today some of those documents that I think help tell that story about this Fourth Provincial Congress and the resolves and the men that met there. But before we start, just take a minute to try to transplant yourself to the town that Larry so eloquently described in the spring of 1776. In this map of 1769 created by the cartographer C.J. Sauffier, we get a glimpse of what Halifax looked like at that time. And at the center of town was the courthouse marked by A here, and then just left of it, marked by B, was the jailhouse. And as delegates from around the state ventured to Halifax, many were present at the start of the Congress, but others filtered in at a much later date. The town was also teeming with people who had been jailed or brought to Halifax in the wake of the Morse Creek uprising, particularly the most prominent Tories. The jails throughout the colony were inadequate to house and confine all of the people who had engaged in this counter-rebellion. And most that were brought to Halifax were some of the ringleaders, people thought responsible for the organization. Many of them would be transported further north to places like Baltimore or Philadelphia. I want to share with you some samples of the journals of the Provincial Congress and the Halifax Resolves, some supplemental documents that are chiefly part of the Secretary of State records in the state archives, and then some other documents that are in other record groups or collections that help us piece together unknown stories. What you see here is a sample page. The first page in what is the original journal of the Fourth Provincial Congress. But what you'll notice is that the first date of this journal is marked April the 27th to May the 13th. And the reason for that, unfortunately, is that the early portion of this journal, this original journal, has not survived, at least in the state archive and or elsewhere that I'm aware of. This journal is what we might refer to as a rough journal. As the secretary of this took notes and recorded the meetings of the Congress, his name was James Green Jr., pretty quickly. So we might think of this as a hastily written journal. But one of the unique facets of this journal that we do not see in the other manuscript version that I'm going to show you shortly, or in published versions, is that there are slight differences in it that give us clues to the types of debates, the types of nominations, or in some cases, perhaps the deliberations that took place. And in the absence of a lot of newspaper reports or diaries and correspondence of those who were in attendance, this journal is critical to understanding some of those deliberations. In this particular page on May 9th, it's noted it was resolved that Thomas Burke and Abner Nash were originally probably appointed as the two delegates to go to Virginia to negotiate with that colony on their assistance in the defense of Ocracoke Inlet. However, their names are stricken through, and in their place are written Alan Jones and Thomas Jones. In yet another example of this journal, on May 11th, an entire section is deleted. In this particular section, the Congress had resolved that the county committees of safety, the local committees that were enforcing the resolves of the Continental Congress and the Provincial Congress, that basically they were given the authority to require people who were threatening to flee the province, to evade debt, to enter into bond and pledge security for their debts. And in the event they did not, or they fled, they were subject to the confiscation of those local committees. But in this particular case, and I don't know that we know the reason for this, this segment, this clause, was actually stricken and does not appear in the same form as the final. This is the only known handwritten copy of the journal of the proceedings of the Provincial Congress, of the Fourth Provincial Congress in North Carolina, that is known to exist. It is the only full copy. It is bound in the state archives along with the earlier Provisional Council journals, the Council of Safety, and the Provincial Congress journals of the Fifth Provincial Congress. It also includes the Declaration of Rights and the draft of the state constitution that were created by the Fifth Provincial Congress in December of 1776. The pages I've highlighted for you here actually show the beginning and the end of our only original copy of the Halifax Resolves, which are inserted into the journal. Larry read the core components of that, but I just know at the end of that resolve, it was unanimous. All of the delegates in attendance agreed that North Carolina was ready to engage in foreign alliances, and it authorized its delegates to associate with the other colonies and declare independence. Like Larry said, a copy of the resolves were sent a day later to the National Archives, and that copy still lives in the National Archives. It's available now, fortunately, on the website fold3.com, as are many other documents related to North Carolina that our state does not have a copy of or custody of. Immediately after the proceedings concluded, as the proceedings concluded, the printer, a New Bern printer by the name of James Davis, who was a newspaper owner, but he also handled most of the state's public business, was ordered to print 5 copies of the journal and to distribute them to the delegates from each county so that they could be disseminated more widely across the colony. I think they were also authorized to print an additional copy for each county or town committee of safety. And the version you see here, the title page, this is the only original version of this published, of the published journal that the State Archives owns. I've seen this in North Carolina and then copies in other institutions. But this particular copy is interesting in that handwriting indicates that it was one of the Mecklenburg County representatives' copies, John McNitt Alexander. And it's also interesting how this particular journal came to be in the archives. Other notes in our records indicate that John Hill Wheeler, who was a noted mid-19th century North Carolinian and an avid collector of North Carolina history, somehow acquired this journal, possibly from descendants of the Alexander family, from whence it eventually found its way into the Secretary of State's office and then was transferred to the state archives. Wheeler, I always like to tell this little tidbit about Wheeler because he's somewhat fascinating. In the middle of the Civil War in 1863, Wheeler boarded a blockade runner called the Advance in Wilmington and under cover of Confederate fire, broke the blockade and went to England in search of colonial era North Carolina documents. I don't think he didn't bring this one back, but he did collect others. I wanted to share some supplemental records that the State Archives has, because I think these records, the journals are very essential to understanding the deliberations of the Congress. But in the absence of a lot of newspaper coverage, diaries, and correspondence, some of the financial records give us deep insights into other people that may have been involved in those proceedings or in support of them. And what you see here is a pay voucher that was issued to one Elizabeth Elbeck. I believe the common spelling is E-E-L-B-E-C-K, but it's spelled in different ways throughout the course of the records, for the use of a room for the Committee of Secrecy, War, and Intelligence. The second sample, though, is one that's slightly more unique. Whereas the first sample that I showed, this is referenced in the journal, as are many of the financial records. The second sample is not referenced in the journals. And the second sample indicates that Mrs. Elbeck also was paid for her allowing the Committee of Claims, the committee the Provincial Congress that was charged with evaluating financial claims presented, receipts, and then issuing payment for them, that she also provided a room for this committee. I think this is extremely important because at the State Archives, we have a lot of records, financial records in particular, that get at the role that women played during the Revolution. And in this case, at the center of the colony's deliberations about wanting to separate itself from what was the most powerful country in the world. And those delegates trusted Elizabeth Elbeck to provide discreetness and a safe space where they can discuss the payment of financial claims. And in the case of a committee of secrecy or intelligence to investigate those conspirators in the Morse Creek uprising. And we know that, other records, that Miss Elbeck owned 2 lots in the town of Halifax. One she had purchased in 1774, which was lot number 72. And then another that I believe she may have inherited, she was a widow. This is just another sample record, a sample financial record, a pay voucher, also that does not appear in the journal. And this particular voucher was issued to Samuel Smith of Johnston County for conveying prisoners from Hillsborough to Halifax. This likely references some of the Morse Creek conspirators who had been rounded up in the wake of that defeat. Throughout the backcountry, a lot of conspirators did not make their way eventually to Morse Creek Bridge. They fled when discovering that there weren't large numbers of British troops to support them. Others fleed, and the colonial militia did a outstanding job intercepting a lot of these loyalist bands. And this particular record indicates that Samuel Smith of Johnston County was charged with delivering a segment of that group. All state archives are a variety of legal documents that were created by the Provincial Congress. On the left, you have a sample of an appearance bond for Robert Adams. And this was a bond that charged, it required Adams to appear before Congress and under subject of fine and imprisonment to answer for his role in the Tory uprising before Morse Creek. In Adams' case, he was actually a Guilford County Tory who was responsible for shooting or shooting at and injuring one of the Guilford County Committee of Safety by the name of William Dent. And interestingly, I mean, Dent signs as one of the bondsmen that is also pledging security for Adams' good behavior and appearance here. To the right is a sample of a parole that's issued to another Tory, Francis Frazier. The jails in North Carolina were simply not adequate to contain all of the people who were involved in this counterinsurgency. And so some many were allowed to go free. And in Frazier's case, he was paroled and limited to the county bounds of Halifax. Other Tories were limited to town bounds. And in some cases, Tories in one part of the state were moved to other parts of state to isolate them. And that's a key component of this provincial Congress is the isolation of loyalist resistance in the colony. And that was undertaken in a variety of different ways. Another kind of document that we have are some of the actual committee reports. Unfortunately, we don't have a report by the committee that was charged with attempting to draft a state constitution in the Fourth Provincial Congress or of drafting the Halifax resolves. But we do have some of the committee reports or fragments of committee reports. And this is a title page of the report of the Committee of Inquiry. And this document is referenced in the journals as being read in two separate places, but it does not appear in those journals. This particular one, it is published in the Colonial and State Records of North Carolina, the wonderful multi-volume set published at the end of the 19th and early 20th century, which is now available online through the University of North Carolina's Documenting the American South. Other kinds of records that we have in the Secretary of State record group are petitions and correspondence that help supplement those journals. In this particular letter that I'm showing, it's dated April the 19th of 1776 and is in the hand of John White. White was the commander of an armed sloop that intercepted a vessel off the coast of North Carolina that was believed to hold British officers and subjects and was thought to be up to no good. And in this particular letter, White is transporting those prisoners to the Provincial Congress in Halifax, then meeting. One of the interesting things about this document is The signature here looks fairly clear to me in that it says John White, but the transcribed version in the journal says Wright, I believe. And I think this is one of the things when historians want to look at original documents, this is why you want to look at those. There are various discrepancies, sometimes misspellings that appear. The second document that I'm showing you, this is actually a draft letter of April the 13th, 1776, from Samuel Johnston, written to the delegates of the Continental Congress. The final version of this letter presumably lives in the National Archives. I did not confirm that, but I'm pretty confident that that's the case. This is the letter that was sent to transport the April 12th Halifax resolves. And in it, it also discusses the fear of invasion of North Carolina, Sir Henry Clinton, British Admiral off the North Carolina coast, the organization of North Carolina Continental Regiment Militia, and of the spirit of which North Carolinians and the delegates at the Constitutional, at the Provincial Congress, adopted the Halifax resolves and were eager and ready to negotiate with foreign alliances and the other colonies. A couple other groups of records that I wanted to highlight, I think also tell us about some other people that were impacted by the actions of the Provincial Congress, particularly enslaved individuals. This document is from the Secretary of State series, and it's another financial claim similar to the ones that I've shown you. And it certifies that Mr. Peter Daig or Dog was allowed 83 pounds, 5 shillings and 6 pence for bringing up McKnight's Negroes, and also 1 pound, 3 shillings for cuffs for those enslaved men that were transported. Supplemental records at the state archives and among the British archives tell us a lot more about those enslaved individuals. These two financial records from a sister series, the Treasurer and Comptroller's Papers, give us additional insight into the seizure and the transport of Thomas McKnight's enslaved men. The Provincial Congress, as it was attempting to mobilize the state to engage in war, it also started to operate or secure the operation of a furnace, an ironworks furnace in Chatham County. And it needed skilled workers to operate that furnace. McKnight's enslaved men were know from records in the audit, in the British records, the audit office series of records, that Thomas McKnight had upwards of, I think, 40 enslaved men who were skilled carpenters, blacksmiths, one local man familiar with McKnight, a wealthy merchant and planter, commented that they could build all by themselves and outfit it. One or two of those enslaved men actually escaped the province of North Carolina along with Thomas McKnight and fled to Britain. But others did not. And they were uprooted from Currituck in Pasquotank County, where Thomas McKnight lived, and they were transported across the colony, first to Halifax, and then to Chatham County, where their skill as blacksmiths and carpenters was put to use in helping in the manufacture of iron. The last document I want to show is what I call the curious case of the Reverend Hezekiah Ford. Hezekiah Ford makes one appearance in the Provincial Council, the Provincial Congress Journal. On April the 8th, he is appointed the chaplain to the Congress. But that's the only reference to him. There's no reference to him ever providing a prayer at the outset of each deliberation. There appear to be few references to him, none that I could find, in the pay vouchers that the state archives holds. However, other records show us that Ford was born in Amelia County, Virginia, died roughly around the time he was born, but he was raised there by his mother and apprenticed to various people there, and he sought out ordination and installation as an Anglican minister in North Carolina, and he was installed in Surry County, North Carolina in 1774. Interestingly, Ford makes his way to Halifax before the delegation of Surry County even arrived. He later serves as a chaplain in the North Carolina Continental Line from roughly 1776 to 1778. However, later correspondence that now survives in the National Archives and in the papers and diaries of John Adams indicate that Ford was a suspected British spy who later served as a clerk to the American diplomat Arthur Lee, and excuse my misspelling there, in Paris from 1778 to 1779. He was so concerned in the Continental Congress over Ford's attachment to Lee was so great that a Virginia assembly called him before them in the spring or summer of 1779 to answer to the charges, which he consistently denied. But mysteriously, Ford seems to have rather disappeared about that time, and some historians and authors suggest that he slipped into British lines in New York and shared materials that he was responsible for transporting. And so I just provide that as an illustration of, I think, some of the lesser characters who attended the Provincial Congress in Halifax, and of who we know not a lot of. And in the case of Anglican ministers, many of them were known to have a tested allegiance to the British government, for which some of them, they were very loyal, but they were in many cases paid by the Society for the Propagation of Gospel. And in northeastern North Carolina, what's known as the Llewellyn Conspiracy, there was an actual plot involving many loyal Anglicans to rise up and seize back control of the colony of North Carolina. I'm not suggesting that's the case with Ford. If anything, I think it's more likely that he was an opportunist who seemed to maybe blown whichever way the wind blew at whatever predicament that he found himself in. But I provide it only as an illustration to show, I think, how little we know about some of the delegates that were in Halifax and some of the other participants, women like Elizabeth Ilbach, and chaplains like Hezekiah Ford, and the enslaved men who were seized and transported across the colony to provide. Thank you. I'm sorry, I had one other one that I wanted to share with you here. This is from our vault collection and removed documents from circulation and have placed them in a secure vault. But they are available in our digital collection. And this is just one example of those. This is John Adams' thoughts on government. It's a rough draft that Adams transported to Thomas Burke, an Orange County representative. And this document is actually one of two copies, I believe, of Adams' thoughts on government that North Carolina's delegates solicited John Adams' opinion to know what kind of government he thought that our colony should create in the spring of 1776. And this is one of two copies, I think, that the State Archives of North Carolina has, and we're lucky to have it. This Adams would later publish his thoughts, and they would become really foundational for the colonies and for the Continental Congress in its creation of a constitution. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vann. That was incredible. We have about 5 minutes left, so we'll get through as many of these questions as we have time for. There's been multiple questions about this. So Vann, while you're with us, since you just spoke, let's go ahead and jump on this one. Folks are wondering what the holes are in the documents that you shared.
Sure. That's a great question. Many people may be familiar with, but others are not. The holes that you see are actually the documents. I don't know if you could tell from my scans, but they were also folded, and the holes that you see are actually indents, or they were a means to ensure that these were not forged, that they had been redeemed. And so when a voucher was issued and a person wanted to redeem it, in North Carolina, these were redeemed in many ways. They were redeemed sometimes for hard currency, for other forms of paper currency. Sometimes they were later redeemed to pay taxes or to purchase land. And the holes that you see were an indication that these had been redeemed so that they could never be recirculated again. And I wanted to add that most of the pay vouchers that are in the State Archive are in the Treasurer and Comptroller's records, and they are now available freely on the website Family Search. But what I showed you here today, these are a different group of pay vouchers that are not available there, that just because the way that the record arrived in the archives from the government agencies, the Secretary of State's office or the Treasurer and Comptroller's office, when Family Search made those available, they did not make other groups of these available. And so some of what you saw is not available online anywhere else.
Wow. Okay. Thank you. The next question is from Deborah. She asks, is there a list of the 83 delegates at the convention? I'm from this area and have ancestors from Halifax, Tarborough, and Scotland Neck.
Yes, there's a list. And in fact, the list is in the document that you just showed that was the formal record. I actually have a reprint of that document that was done in 1976, and it has a list of all the documents representatives that attended and where they were from. There were representatives from various towns. The important towns had representatives. Then there were representatives from particular areas. There were more than 83 were elected, only 83 came. I think one of the interesting stories is that Wiley Jones from Halifax was an elected delegate, but he was out of town on business. And the people in Halifax thought it was so important. They asked the Congress to allow them to have a special election April 4th, April 5th, and they had an election in 24 hours and elected a new delegate so that they could have that vote at the Provincial Congress. Can you imagine an election that occurred in 24 hours?
I can't.
Different times. Another thing about one of the prisoners, I will add that some of the British officers were just allowed to roam around Halifax free as long as they reported back to the jail at night. So you'd find them in the taverns and other places around Halifax during this period of time. It was a very different day.
So we have time for one very quick question left. And I think this is a great place to stop. Eric asks, how can we help ensure that this story isn't lost to the ages?
Well, you say you only got a minute. We probably need about an hour to talk about that. Well, you can join our organizations. That's our purpose. And I will throw in at this point that our organizations have just created what we call a master plan and vision statement for growing and developing the historic site. And it talks about all the things we want to see happen in Halifax. Unfortunately, nobody's doing research right now in this area. Nobody at the colleges. We're actually going to probably hire some people to do research, but there's nobody actually doing that research now. And all of the accounts you read you can find references to the resolves and to the Provincial Congress in a lot of places, but it's a superficial account of what occurred. The RDW Connor account that I've read from is the most complete account I've seen, and it's not very detailed. And if you try to do internet research, you find the same thing over and over again. So no in-depth research is being done. One of the things we're asking people to do in our organization is select one of these delegates, do the genealogy, find out who his descendants are, and see if they've got any papers or any evidence that we could use to help put together this story. So we're trying to do that here in Halifax, but in all candor, there's not a lot of that being done. There are just not that many people interested in this period of history anymore, and the research is not being done.
Stacy, can I just say one quick thing?
Of course.
So, and I, on top of what Larry said, I just add that, you know, support the Museum of History. The State Archives of North Carolina also has a friends group that helps support us. And you can visit our website, archives.ncdcr.gov. And that helps us preserve these documents to make them more widely available. And we are engaged in the course of the America 250 celebration. It is in the planning to make a lot of these records that are not available digitally, to make more of those available with the knowledge that and hope that that will stimulate wider accessibility and more scholarship, especially in these tough times where not as many people are traveling to do research and taking those trips. So I think, you know, that is something that the archives is committed to. And you can certainly, if there are research questions that people in attendance might have about particular documents or records, you're more than welcome to email us at archives@ncdcr.gov, or you can email me directly, vann.evans@ncdcr.gov, and I'm happy to try to help you or refer you to someone else who can.
I would add, visit these historic sites, because the more visitors they get, the more money that flows to them, and the more money that flows to them, the more that we can do to develop this history.
Absolutely. We're all looking forward to times when we can get back out there and visit all of our favorite historic sites.
We're open now on a limited basis. They are open.
Yep. All right. Well, gentlemen, I want to thank you so much for such an incredible program. What a special treat it was for all of us to take a closer look at the events leading up to and surrounding the resolves, and then also these lesser known archival materials relating to the resolves. It was just wonderful. So thank you both so much. And
tell them this recording will be available, because I've just seen somebody ask that question.
Yes. So thank you. Yes. This is being recorded, and it will be available within a week on the museum's YouTube channel under the History and Highballs playlist. And I just want to thank all of those of you who joined us this evening. We hope that you enjoyed this wonderful program, and we hope to see you at our next History and Highballs, a walk in the woods with Carl Sandburg, as part of our National Poetry Month programming. That's happening on Thursday, April 29th at 7 p.m. Have a wonderful evening. Stay safe, and we'll see you all soon. Take care, everybody.